And turn with me, if you will, to the New Testament book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 3, beginning at verse 5. We are reading today from the New King James Version, and our entire scripture lesson text can be found on the insert in your bulletin. 1 Corinthians, chapter 3, verse 5. Who then is Paul, and who is Apollos, but minister through whom you believed, as the Lord gave to each one? I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. Now he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. According to the grace of God, which was given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another builds on it. But let each one take heed how he builds on it. For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or straw, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built upon it endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as through fire. Pray with me this morning as we examine this text with this thought in mind. Signing up as God's co-worker. Signing up as God's co-worker. Let's pray. Our Father and our God in heaven, we thank you once again for the privilege and opportunity of standing before these thy people. And Lord, we pray now that the words of my mouth and that the meditation of all our hearts will be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Let the redeemed of the Lord say, amen. Before I retired 9 years ago, I was in the computer training business, and part of the training that I did was hands-on lab work. So I had about a dozen computers that I had to set up before I could teach each class. And setting up and connecting all the computers took me about 1 hour. In fact, I had got it down so well that I could consistently go into the customer site and set up all the computers in 1 hour and have all the computers ready to go in 1 hour. Unless some of the customer staff decided to help me set up, and then it took me 2 hours or more, because as well-meaning as they were always end up slowing me down. So I generally declined the customer helping me set up because they would just slow me down, because we weren't working together. They were doing things and it was interfering with what I was trying to do. But 1 year I had a contract to teach at the Offutt Air Force Base out in Nebraska. And I had a contract to fly. I flew out there and I taught a class to the airmen out there. They were computer experts, and I was teaching them IBM's latest computers. And so I couldn't get on the base that night before, so I had to get in that morning, and I only had about a half hour to set things up, so I was running behind. And so one of the young airmen asked me if they could help me set up. Now, again, I was generally leery because of past experience, but since I was so far behind, I said yes. And it was 6 young airmen took a job that took normally 1 hour, and those young men got that job done in 10 minutes. Because they knew how to work together. Being airmen, military people, they knew how to work together. They weren't getting each other. I just stood back and watched them work, and it took 10 minutes for them because they knew how to work as a team. And I didn't get it at first, but these guys were trained to work as a team. So I was astonished by how working together can be so effective. And that brings me to what Paul was talking to the church at Corinth. He was telling the church at Corinth, and all the church today, that when you learn how to work together, you can get a lot accomplished. Many Christians are confused about Christian work because they don't understand the value or the nature of the work that they're supposed to be doing. So you have people working against each other in the church and nothing gets done. God has called us to be his co-workers. To do this work effectively, we need to have understanding of the work to which we call. That's the first problem. You don't understand what the job is that you've been called to do. So if we understand our role in the Lord's work, we can be effective. And the Lord wants us to be effective co-workers, and always him always have to pull us back from doing the wrong thing, and that slows down the work of the kingdom. The question is, how can we be effective in the Lord's work? Well, the answer's in the text. So let's turn through this text and listen as the Apostle Paul tells the church then and now what we need to do to be effective co-workers for the Lord. So looking at the text again, beginning at verse 5, it says, "Who then is Paul and who is Apollos, but ministers through whom you believed, as the Lord gave to each one? I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase." We can only be effective co-workers for God when we learn that our work is not a competition. This work is not a competition one with another. Christian work is not something that we do for bragging rights. When that happens, we cease to be God's co-workers and we're really working for ourselves, for our own egos and satisfaction. The Corinthian church had disputes going on about who had received the best teaching. Some had been taught by the Apostle Paul himself, and they were bragging about that. And others who were bragging that Apollos, that great and eloquent preacher that Luke wrote about in the book of Acts, had been their teacher. So if we back up to what Paul said in verse 1 of this chapter, we can see the beginning of this discussion. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 1 says, "And I, brethren, could not speak to you as spiritual people, but as carnal, as to babes in Christ. I fed you with milk and not with solid food, for until now you were not able to receive it. And even now you're still not able, for you are still carnal. For where there are envy, strife, and division among you, are you not carnal and behaving like mere men? For when one says, 'I am of Paul,' another says, 'I am of Apollo,' are you not carnal?" Paul told them that they were acting like children. They were spiritually immature. Children play and quarrel about meaningless things, but grown-ups go to work. Grown-ups go to work and get the job done. You have to be a grown-up to do God's work. You have to be a grown-up to be God's co-worker, because God does not have time for petty and selfish disputes. Adults push the petty aside and do the work that God has set before them. Paul told the church at Corinth that they were carnal and childish. Now, Paul is talking to church folks, to Christians. And carnal means that you are worldly and not spiritual. So what does it mean to be a carnal Christian? It means that even though you have received the Holy Spirit, you are still allowing your life to be controlled by your own nature instead of being controlled by the Spirit of God. You're still following the ways of the world and the ways of the flesh and the ways of the devil. You're still wearing your old clothes instead of putting on the new clothes that God has given you to wear. But when we grow up spiritually, we realize that we're not in competition with other Christians or with other churches. Our battle is against spiritual wickedness in high places and even in low places. Spiritual wickedness in the world, in the government, in the church, and on the street corner, and even in our own hearts. That's the battle that we face, fighting off spiritual wickedness. And the devil is spreading the notion today that the word of God is irrelevant to living in 21st century. He's spreading that far and wide. But the work of the church is the work of spreading the gospel of the kingdom of God. That's what we should be about. Spreading the gospel of the kingdom of God. When churches and the people in those churches realize that all of our work should be towards kingdom building, then there will be no room for ownership or for bragging. If we all realize that we're working for the kingdom of God. Ownership doesn't even sound right when you're talking about the kingdom. That doesn't sound right. I've heard of folks bragging about their church, saying my church is this and my church is that. But I've never heard anyone bragging about my kingdom. My kingdom is this, my kingdom is that. The only person I heard bragging about his kingdom was Jesus. And that's the way it should be. Because the kingdom is the Lord's. And the work is the Lord's. And when you understand that the only work that you can do for the Lord is kingdom work, then you are ready to be God's co-worker. Only then. For example, years ago when I first joined one of the very large churches in Milwaukee, I won't name it, but I had just joined and I saw something that I could not understand. There was one choir group that was cussing angry on a Sunday morning because another choir group, they had multiple choirs, was singing their song. They said, "How dare he sing our song?" And I'm singing, how can you be mad about one singing? We're singing praises to God. Why can you be mad about somebody else singing praises to God? Are you not carnal? You know, I didn't know the term then, but that's carnality. I could not understand how groups inside the church could feel that they are in competition with other groups. And you see that among churches, they're competing one with another. I still can't understand it, but it exists, and it existed for 2,000 years because Paul was writing about the same thing in the Corinthian church. And the devil uses that competition to stifle the work of God. If he can get you working in competition, then he knows that you won't be doing God's work. You won't be doing it. We destroy our effectiveness for the Lord when the church tries to compete within the church against other churches. Paul said, one plants and another waters. The planter is not competing with the waterer. They're both hoping God will bless their work. Planting and watering would both be for nothing unless God decides to grow some seed. You just do your job to the glory of God. Let God do the rest. So we can only be effective co-workers for God when we learn that our work is not a competition. It's important that we understand that fact. But there's another very important fact that we need to grasp. We're not working trying to get into heaven. We're not trying to compete to get into heaven. Look at verse 11 of Corinthians chapter 3. Paul writes, "For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is." We can only be effective co-workers of God when we learn that our work is not for our salvation. It's not for our salvation. Your salvation is based on your faith in Jesus Christ, not upon the works that you do. Faith happens first. Good works follow faith. Because of your faith, you do the work for the Lord. It cannot happen the other way around. Your good works don't produce your salvation. You can't pile up enough good works that God will say, "Oh, you're so good, I'm going to save you." God saved you first, and then he tells you to go to work. That's the way it works. And you're not piling up good works trying to impress God so that he will save you. And if you were trying to do that, I'm here to tell you that that won't work. That won't work. And the Bible tells us that in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, where Paul writes, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." In other words, God didn't save us because of our works. God saved us so that we could do the works that he's already laid out for us to do. God saved you by his grace, and your works show gratitude and obedience to the God who has saved you. Any works that are done without faith and before faith are worthless. They're worthless. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 says, "But without faith it is impossible to please him, for he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him." God deals in faith. God's dealing with Abraham is a prime example of faith coming before works. God made a promise to Abraham, and because Abraham believed what God told him, God instantly declared Abraham as righteous. Before he had performed any works, God labeled Abraham as righteous and put that on Abraham's account. Listen as Paul writes about that in Romans chapter 4, verse 3. He said, "For what does Scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Now to him who works, the wages are not counted as grace, but as debt. But to him who does not work, but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is accounted for righteousness." We don't work for God to get saved. We work because we have been saved, because God has saved us. And we want to keep on doing good works because God has saved us, and we're just grateful for his grace and his mercy. Now, there are all kinds of works that we can do, good works and bad works. So we need to be careful and diligent about the kind of work that we do for the Lord, in the name of the Lord. So look at the text again, beginning at verse 12. The text said that there are different kinds of work that we can do, and God will reveal the truth about our work. It says in verse 12 that there is gold and silver and jewels, precious stones are the kind of good works that will not burn up in fire. These are the works that hold up when God looks into our hearts and examines our motives. Some works may look good to other folks, but when God looks at the motives in your heart, they burn up like a flash fire. But when you put gold in a fire, it doesn't burn up, it becomes purified. Any surface dirt on the gold gets burned off, and just pure gold remains. Sometimes God allows us to go through a fire, not for punishment, but to purify us. Sometimes God has to burn off some things that's wrong in us, and the only way he can do that is through the fire of tribulation. But on the other hand, wood, hay, and straw. Now, I mean, you can make some good-looking things out of wood and hay and straw, and they may look good to other folks, but they cannot withstand the fire of God's truth. They burn up, and those are the works that we do for other folks to see. They look good on the outside, but when God's truth sets in, they burn up. And Jesus speaks about those kind of works in Matthew chapter 6, verse 1. He says, take heed that you do not do your charitable deeds before men to be seen by them. Otherwise, you have no reward from your Father in heaven. Therefore, when you do a charitable deed, do not sound the trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory for men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But when you do a charitable deed, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, that your charitable deed may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will himself reward you openly. Jesus said, do it, don't brag about it, just do it in secret. God sees it, and if you do it in secret, God will openly bless you for what you've done out of a pure heart. Those wood, hay, and straw works will burn up, and they're for show for other folks to see, but what about the gold works? What do they look like? Gold works are the works that you do for God, even though no one else might know about it. Even though no one else, you might not get any credit for it. You just do it because you know that God wants you to do it. Gold works are the works that require you to give up something that means something to you. Something that requires a sacrifice on your part. And it's no sacrifice to give God something that you don't want. In fact, that's an insult. To give God something that you don't want and didn't cost you anything, that's an insult to God. That's why God said he never allowed Israel to sacrifice any sick animals. I don't want your sick animals. I want your best animal so that I know that it's a sacrifice. When you sacrifice to the Lord in a way that honors him, God will bless your sacrifice. So what am I talking about? I'm talking about things like your time, your talent, and your treasure. And those are things that we all have. When out of a sincere heart we give God our time, God honors that. God honors that. When we give our talents to the Lord from a sincere heart, God honors that. When we give God our treasure out of a willing and a cheerful heart, God honors that. Now, David is a good example of what a sacrifice to the Lord should look like. David wanted to make a sacrifice to the Lord. And David offered to buy a building and some oxen from a man and some land to order to offer a sacrifice to the Lord. The man's name was Araunah. And Araunah said, for you, O king, the land is free. I'll give it to you. And David said, no way. I'm not offering anything to the Lord that didn't cost me anything. David said this in 2 Samuel chapter 24, verse 24. Then the king said to Araunah, no, but I will surely buy it from you for a price. Nor will I offer a burnt offering to the Lord my God with that which costs me nothing. So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. David said, I will not present to my God an offering that costs me nothing. So remember that when you're giving something, a sacrifice, an offering should be a sacrifice, something that you could use, but you're giving it up to for the Lord's sake. That's a sacrifice. That's an offering. So David knew that God is worthy of our best sacrifice, not just the leftovers. Because God has already saved us, we should offer our best gifts to the Lord. Because God has already saved us, we should offer our best work to the Lord. Because God has already saved us, we should offer all of our talents to the Lord's work. Because God has already saved us, we should offer our treasures, whatever we have, to the Lord's work. If we think that we need to earn our salvation, we'll attempt to do the wrong kind of work and end up leaving the Lord's work undone. We'll want to do some grand deed to secure our salvation if we think that's how it comes. And what the Lord wants is just a simple act of kindness. A simple act at the right time, the right act at the right time when he gives us opportunity is what the Lord wants. To be obedient when he calls us to reach out and help someone. We can only be effective co-workers of God when we learn that our work is not for our salvation. So we need to understand deep inside our souls that we're not working for salvation. God has already given us that. He's granted that. But does that mean our work has no meaning? Does it mean that God does not notice the work that we do in his name? No, it doesn't mean that at all. In fact, just the opposite. Look at verse 14. Where Paul writes, if anyone's work which he has built upon endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet as through fire. We can only be effective co-workers of God when we learn that our work will not be forgotten by God. Our work will not be forgotten by God. After we understand that we're not working to try to get into heaven, we can deal with the fact that the Lord does reward faithful service. He does reward faithful service. God will not forget your works. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10 says, for God is not unjust to forget your work and labor of love which you have shown towards his name, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. God will not overlook your works. The Lord knows how to reward faithful works. Sometimes we might feel shortchanged. And sometimes it even seems that evil gets reward while good gets punished. That's happening in this world today. But don't let the devil fool you. God will not be mocked. We will all reap what we sow. That's a promise from God, Galatians 6:7. Both good and bad. So if we planted good seeds, God will bring you fruit from that good seeds. He will not hold back. And if we planted bad seeds, you know, like gossip and hateful speech and all those other things, that's going to bring a reward as well, but you won't like it. But if your works hold up, you'll be rewarded by God. If your works don't hold up, you'll lose your reward, but you won't lose your salvation. God saved you by his grace, and God will judge your works to see if you're going to get a reward or not. So that raises a question, at least it did to me when I first heard it. If we're standing at the gates of heaven, assured of getting in by the blood of Jesus, knowing that we're getting in by what Jesus did and not by our works, what kind of reward can we expect? You know, what more can the Lord give us? If we're ready to come into heaven and the Lord is judging to see whether we're going to get, you know, rewards or not, you know, what else is there? Well, God has ways. Don't you want to know the answer to that question? How else God can bless you as you stand against him? What does God have to give you? Don't you want to know the answer to that question? So do I. Well, the Bible doesn't tell us. So we just have to wait till we get there to find out. But the word of God says that he has more rewards for you than those you receive down here. If you just be faithful, you can be sure of that. No one will be able ever to accuse God of shortchanging them. The Lord knows your works. So listen as Jesus shows the church of his knowledge and the rewards for their works. In Revelation, this is the risen Christ. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 19, the Lord says, I know your works, your love, sacrifice, and faith, and your patience. And as for your works, the last are more than the first. In other words, Jesus told this church, you're getting better than you started out. So you're doing well. In the verse 25 of Revelation 2, he says, but hold fast what you have till I come. And he who overcomes and keeps my works until the end, to him I will give power over the nation. So Jesus, I'm bringing even more power into your hands just by being faithful to what I've called you to do. Lord says, hold on till I come. Don't get weary in well-doing. Just keep doing the work that I've left for you to do. And to those who say that the Christian life is supposed to be a life of drudgery and misery, waiting for the pie in the sky after a while after we die type of blessing, for those who've heard the devil put down the Christian faith in that way, listen to what Jesus tells his disciples about the rewards in this life and in heaven. Jesus spoke to his disciples in Mark chapter 10, verse 28. Then Peter began to say to him, see, we have left all and followed you. So Jesus answered and said, assuredly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake and the gospel's who shall not receive 100-fold now in this time houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions and in the age to come eternal life. The Lord has promised to grant blessings in this life to those who are his faithful workers. In this life. The Lord's promised to send blessings in the midst of the persecutions. Now, don't miss that. So many of us wait for the persecution, the trouble to stop for the Lord to bless us. And Lord, I'm going to bless you right in the middle of whatever's going on in your life. In fact, that's the way the Lord likes to do that. Right in the middle of when you're being persecuted and troubled, the Lord says, I won't take the trouble away, but here's something for you. I'm going to give you something that the world cannot take away from you. God doesn't have to stop everything to bless you. He can bless you right where you are. And when your days down here run out, your rewards will continue on into glory. That's the Lord's promise. In fact, the testimony of Scripture is that God is an overachiever when it comes to giving reward. He's an overachiever. We spend too much time worried about getting rewarded for what we do that we don't do the work that we should be doing. So we should let God worry about the rewards because he knows how to do that. We just need to do the work that he's given us to do. What Jesus is saying to his disciples then and now, don't worry about getting paid. God is trustworthy. My Father is trustworthy. Don't worry about what you've given up. God is wealthy. He can cover your losses. Don't worry about your sacrifice. God is faithful. He will not forget you. Don't worry about your battle scars. God is all powerful. He can bind up your wounds. He can heal you. You just need to set your mind to work hand in hand with the Lord. If your work endures through the fire of God's truth, the Lord will bless you. If your motives are pure, when God examines your heart, the Lord will bless you. If your sacrifice is real, when God examines the work that you lay before him, the Lord will bless you. He'll do that. So we can only be effective co-workers of God when we learn that our work will not be forgotten by God. So now we return to the question with which we started. How can we be effective as God's co-workers? We can only be effective co-workers for God when we understand the nature of the work that God has called us to do. We can be effective as God's co-workers when we understand that our work is not a competition. It's not a competition. On the day of Pentecost, the Bible says that the followers of Jesus were all with one accord in one place. And at that instant, the Holy Spirit came with power and the church was born. Kingdom work will be effective only when we learn how to work in harmony. The church was in one accord in one place, and God just blessed them with the power of the Holy Spirit. We can be effective co-workers of God when we understand that we need to learn to work together and not in competition. We can be effective as God's co-workers when we understand that our work is not for our salvation. Because God has already granted us salvation, we should do his work out of a grateful heart. We can be effective as God's co-workers when we understand that our work will not be forgotten by God. When we realize that no matter how small or insignificant our work looks in our own eyes, God sees every faithful work done in his name as an act of obedience. It's a great and pure treasure to God to see an obedient act, no matter how small. And God rewards our obedience with mighty blessings, whether great or small. And we need to get this right. We need to get this right because this work, this kingdom work for the Lord, is all that matters. That's the only thing that matters. The work that you do out of a sincere heart for the Lord is all that's going to matter in your eternity. Listen to the Lord's promise again, Revelation 2:25. But hold fast what you have till I come. And he who overcomes and keeps my works until the end, to him I will give power over the nations. The Lord says, keep doing my work and I'll give you power. So I'm going to keep working for the Lord because I need the Lord's power in my life. I'm going to keep working for the Lord because I need the Lord's power when trouble clouds my mind and challenges my peace. I'm going to keep working for the Lord because I need the Lord's power when doubt approaches my heart and challenges my faith. I'm going to keep working for the Lord because I need the Lord's power when worry slips into my soul and challenges my joy. I'm going to keep working for the Lord because I need the Lord's comfort when I start getting worried. I'm going to keep working for the Lord because I need the Lord's presence when I start feeling lonely and all alone. I'm going to keep working for the Lord because I need the Lord's strength when I start to get weak sometimes. I'm going to keep working for the Lord because I need the Lord's guidance when I get lost in this world. I'm going to keep working for the Lord. That's what I'm going to do. What about you? What about you? Shall we stand as the choir leads us in song?